I've loved, absolutely loved working on Grand, simply because it was the music being the master and me being the servant to the music, and the choice of music gave me so much flexibility. And also it represents best what I believe in, which is giving the dancers each individual opportunities to be themselves. And I think that's what I've been trying to do with Sydney Dance Company for a long time, find the key to certain dancers and unlock that key so that they have, at the end of their stay with Sydney Dance Company, something that they feel is really their own. And that's a lovely thing. But of course, this work is really, at the heart of this work is the piano. And at the heart of the piano for me is my mother, Betty, who died last year. And so this is a tribute to her. And a tribute, of course, to the instrument. I mean, the instrument's very center stage in this piece. It's not an accompaniment, it's part of the main arena. I think that Grand perhaps represents one of the best collaborative events that I've ever been involved with. I absolutely feel that what Gerard Mannion, the designer, contributed, what Akira Isagawa, costume designer, attributed, and what the Damien Cooper's lighting and choreography somehow has come together on exactly the right level, the right plane. All ingredients seem to me to be very equal. Grand for me is a journey to the heart of the piano. Everything that is in Grand comes from the instrument, explodes out of it. The set comes from it, the costumes are based on it. And of course, the lighting even reflects the instrument. But for me, of course, Grand is a tribute to my mother, who was my favorite pianist. I'm very tenacious. When I find somebody I like working with, I tend to stick with them long term. I look at composers like Carl Vine, who I've been working with since he was 20 and I was 25. But in the instance more recently, I've set up a relationship with Akira Isagawa, who comes from a completely different world, the world of fashion. And I was bold enough to say, Akira, would you consider coming into the world of dance? And he didn't hesitate. And that the first collaboration with him was on Salome. And of course, being a first collaboration, it was possibly more difficult because he had to discover the horrors of dance costumes, which have to be as durable as possible, have to be washed nightly, have to be unrestrictive for the dancers. And so he very quickly understood the poetry of dance and the poetry that he creates with fabric. And that marriage began. Since then, there's been air and other invisible forces. There's been Ellipse, and now, most recently, Grand. So it's 4 times I've worked with Akira, and I don't think it's going to be the last. I really love the way that he gets it on that level of poetry. The company has had 30 extraordinary years. Every decade's been completely different. Every decade we've achieved something, or we've aimed to achieve something, and we've been successful. Every decade's come with its own problems, financial, but artistically, I think we've had a clear line of progress through that period. And we've always been very true to the art form, and that's always come first. I don't think there's been a period in that time when we've actually sold out to commerciality, even though we've had works that have been commercially successful. They weren't ever created with that in mind. They were always created with the integrity of the piece. If I look at the first decade, it was really about establishing contemporary dance in Australia. It was so important. There wasn't an audience for contemporary dance. We had minute audiences until really Poppy, in that first 3 or 4 years of the company, launched us both nationally and internationally. And that was the most important point because that gave us such confidence. That said, look, you know, we are here and we have something to say. Of course, it was also very important. The international success of that made a lot of Australians feel, oh my lord, these are not just, you know, the local contemporary dance. These are people who are valued on the international scene. And that was the beginning of our newfound confidence. Of course, it was only a few years later after that, you know, because of funding, etc., because of the losses of country touring, we were struggling to survive yet again. But the tenacity of this company is what I absolutely adore, its ability to bounce back. And we've always bounced back.
Where does that come from?
Well, we've always bounced back through the art form. It's always been an art-driven recovery for us. And that comes absolutely from the dancers. I am so dependent on them for inspiration. I rely completely on individuals within the company to make me want to do the next work. I mean, it would be so easy to give up so often. But when I look at, sometimes it's the newest, youngest, or when I see a dancer who's reaching a beautiful maturity, I go, I can't wait to create for those people. And it amazes me that I didn't get jaded and give up a long time ago, but I know why. It is because of the external force of those artists that surround me, my ever-changing palette of colors and taste and flavor that they bring my life, that has kept me going. It amazes me when I look back on the amount of work that we produce, because basically we've been producing one or two or sometimes three new works a year over that 30-year span. And you go, well, at what point does that become a chore? And as I said, never if you love the people you're working with, and never if you're finding new artists in composers, designers, costume designers, lighting designers, because every new discovery gives you at least a 6-7 year fuel. But it's been fun. I mean, we do a work like Tivoli, which is done because I have a great affection for the past and the nostalgia of the music hall as it grew in Australia through the Tivoli circuit. And you have a work like that that suddenly brings you a whole new audience, some of whom stick and come to the next thing, even if it is much more esoteric than, say, Tivoli. But Tivoli was just extraordinary because Tivoli developed a whole new fan base for us, but a whole new skill base for the performers. They found things that they never thought they'd do. They were singing, they were doing acrobatic feats, they were contortionists, they were comedians. And that was wonderful. Going back even further, a couple of decades, 88, Vast, a work that combined the forces of the four regional companies. Together, we formed a company and produced a work that had an enormous impact on many, many people as it toured Australia to celebrate what we were in 1988. So, works come along very specifically that regenerate the way you think, that are so out of the box, that are so left field, and yet they contribute something that is lasting. Often an audience, but often a confidence, which is even more important. I think you have to remember that the Sydney Dance Company, one of the unique aspects of it is that we're not afraid of narrative. So many contemporary dance companies think of the esoteric music plus movement, or even movement above music. We've varied our approach so broadly, but always we come back to the narrative, the engagement that an audience can get when they're emotionally connected to characters that they can feel something for. And of course that started with the biographical work in the first decade of Poppies, and went on to works like After Venice, which brought to the fore stars like Paul Mercurio, etc. Then it moved on. There were other works later, at the coming into the next decade, works that took us into Berlin, which to me is still one of the strongest work that the company has, which you would say is not so much a narrative as a mood piece that captures the feeling of a city. I have to say that the narrative work is very important to this company, because the dancers in this company want to be more than just instruments of a choreographer. They want to have an impact through their own contribution as actors and as performers and as artists. And the narrative allows them a new freedom that is not just purely physical. I have to think about that. I mean, you know, every now and then we have, I think, what I call seminal works that actually push us into a new direction or bring us disrepute or have a shock value that also wakens up another generation of dance-interested people. I think of very strongly of the works that I call the disruptive works, the works like Fornicon, which dealt with censorship. The works like After Venice, which I did at the beginning of the very beginning of the AIDS crisis, the works like Shades of Grey, which was really about the complacency today, as told through the eyes of Dorian Gray, about the complacency that allows AIDS to continue in this decade. So we have a lot of those wake up works that often dance people have a real problem with, because they really want a lot of people, and not audiences so much as reviewers, want the status quo not to be rocked too much in dance. They want the comfort of what they want. It's very much easier for them to accept a non-narrative work or a narrative work that has no sort of real kick to it. But it's so important that this company's kept ruffling feathers. And that's, I think, the key in some ways to our survival. The fact that we can get up people's noses still after 30 years is a very good sign.
And yet, as somebody said to me, somebody made a comment to me, and I have a range of your audiences. You have very, very young people and very old people. Why?
I just adore the demographic of our audiences. They are poor, they are rich, they are old, they are young, they are male, they are female, they are off the street or out of the big end of town. I mean, it is so exciting. And it is so important to me, because I see so many theatre and dance companies that have a niche audience that is clearly a type. And for me, dance was always about getting it out there. And I think that's the variety of works that I keep doing. And sometimes it's uncomfortable because people see a work and they think, oh, I like that. Oh, I've got their number. I'm coming to the next one. I'll see something so completely different, so out of left field that they must go, I think I've come to the wrong company. and that's important. I think that for me, the most important thing a dance work can do is engage you emotionally. And how you make that engagement happen varies enormously. I want my audiences to care about what they see, not to sort of treat it like, you know, a nice entertainment for my delight and, you know, to give me a nice night out. I like to think that our audience's mind is engaged. I like to think that they're experiencing almost physically what they're seeing. I want my audience to feel the movement and to be part of it. It's the connection and the communication that I really care about in this art form. And I hope to develop dancers that are great communicators with an audience, that drag you into their world and are not just regarded as beautiful technical things to be admired like a vase or a painting, but as something human that makes you connected to the human condition. I mean, for me, choreography, or dance is a language. Dance is a language, and the better you dance it, the more skilled your language is, the more clever your use of language. But choreography really is just simply taking that language and having something interesting to say with it. Because without saying something with dance, it is just movement, it is just exercise, it is just aerobics, it is just circus. The difference is that when you take that language and you say something that fascinates people or upsets people, it's like a novelist who can use the word and engage you completely. That's the duty of a choreographer. You know, there's a 7-year itch to this. I mean, we really have had probably 4 major funding crises in the history of Sydney Dance Company. And we've managed to deal with them. We've been virtually in liquidation, in receivership. The receiver gave up in despair because he said that a dance company can't ever make profit. We did some rooms which has had hundreds and hundreds of performances and dragged us out of the hole financially. We're great at self-help. But unfortunately, the big term picture, companies, arts companies need the support and the love of a government and the respect of a government. And so these crises that happen will continue forever unless the actual funding of the company has got right.
Is there a difference between what you have to deal with in Australia and the way the same companies or art is treated around the world?
I think that there's great variety with the way, but I think you can sense very easily which countries have the government and the care of the government behind them, because they're the companies where the arts are blossoming, and it's quite fascinating. But
are we going backwards?
We are staying absolutely still. I mean, our funding has changed so little over the decades. Of course, costs have. And of course, you know, the world has changed incredibly around us. But the government hasn't moved with that. And that's always going to be a problem. And that brings us to the point that, okay, what do we do? Well, we self-help. We do works that hopefully generate box office, but because we're a risk-taking company, you can't always guarantee that, because we are more, it's more important that we push the envelope than we sit on a format. It's much, much more important. We do things like develop external classes, which generate great revenue and contribute to the health and well-being of the citizens of Sydney. Our classes have doubled in size and in income, so that's an income stream that we can help. We've pushed sponsorship, and we've had to do all this. We've done philanthropy. We've picked up the phone in the crisis times and rung people. We've had governments, fleeting governments, who cared so much that you could actually go direct to them and say, listen, we need help. But the times currently aren't as healthy. And the arts really have got to start speaking up, or we could disappear. You only have to look and question and scratch just below the surface, and you'll see a lot of companies in crisis.
Why do you think? Do you think it's the globalization? It's the way business is conducted, careless? Why is culture so unimportant?
Because votes are more important. You know, the arts vote can be huge, but the public have to sort of, you know, the public have to rally into these things. And of course, red herrings flying everywhere. There are a million other crises, and I've absolutely appreciate, you know, the problems of society, you know, with hospitals, with wars, with etc. But the mark of health and the mark of maturity in any culture is its arts. And I sometimes think that value those and other things fall into place, not the other way around. At the moment, the arts sort of gets dragged along behind everything. But if you look at society and so often in history, demise has been reflected in the death of arts. The death of the arts. Fascinating. I think you could do a great sort of psychological research into where the two meet. I feel really confident that healthy arts mean healthy society, mean adventurous society, mean more stimulation, mean more experimentation, mean sciences respond. Things work through this medium. If you leave a theatre stimulated, then that stimulation goes into your life and into your everyday world. Very important. A lot of people talk about, you know, the Sexy Sydney Dance Company and how it uses, ruthlessly uses the body as a promotional tool. But of course, the body is our medium. The body is the way we tell our stories. So we can't be ashamed about that. But neither are we blatant about it. I mean, what we do is a glorification of the human form. But the human form is the capsule in which we all live and should be polished and looked after and respected greatly. So I'm totally unashamed of our connection to that physicality and its permeation through my work over 3 decades. You know, it's interesting if you think about the artist and the maturing of an artist. Do composers give up midstream because there's another composer biting at their ankles? Did I give up because there were people ahead of me? And I go, oh, I'm just going to sit around and wait until they die. No, you fight, you move on, you do better, you do better, you find your niche. And that's what's important. It's not a bike and everyone should have a turn. Art is not a bike. Art is the individual fighting on, finding the new, moving on. I mean, should Picasso have stopped to let Matisse have a better go?
And it's not like you have a nurture talents while you did that. Maybe you could say something like, wait for that plan.
When I think that an artist maturing and the growth and every work you do and every new artist you work with takes you somewhere else. It is a journey. And like life, these journeys can be stopped midstream. So many times I thought to myself, this is unbearable. What you put up with outside of the art, the funding, the meetings, the boards, the issues that you have to put up with are absolute torture. And I think nothing is worth this. And then I see a young artist, and then I see a Stephen Page who comes through the company, and I see that talent, and I go, I know that's going to go somewhere, something to say. I see a Paul Mercurio who comes and moves into other areas, a Kim Walker who now has Flying Fruit Fly. I see Gideon, and I go, I'm so happy that this company existed, because this company showed them the possibility of what can happen. They didn't go, I want Graham Murphy's company. They went, I want to be my own person. And that's what one should encourage. And these companies like this are so important as springboard for other people's personal creativity. Absolutely vital. If you look at a Balanchine, for instance, no Americans were running around saying he's been choreographing since, you know, for 80 years. He's been at that, the head of that. No one said, oh, he's now in his 80s, please stop him. They were fascinated because his language was more refined. It changed over the years. I think if you don't change, you're dead and then you move on. But I think when there's still joy to be had and when there's still incredible talent to be nurtured, it's a shocking policy that Australians have that new is better. It applies to restaurants. You know, a restaurant comes, it lasts a week and people move on. It doesn't matter how good, it's about going to the next one. That's why I think our achievement of 30 years has been so extraordinary, because they keep coming back for another meal.
Thank you, Glenn.